Good afternoon, everybody. We shall continue our schedule. I hope you succeeded all obtaining the output texture files, at least, of the simulation. There were several cases to run. And now we will see how it can be examined. So for that purpose, for the textures, a very suitable software is JTEX from Metz, and which is right here on the screen. It's created by Benoît Beausire and Jean-Jacques van den Berger, two of my young colleagues. So it's a free software, and it's independent. It's not using MATLAB, like, for example, the MTEX software, which is, I think, a commercial type of software, and it requires the existence of MATLAB. This is one package, independent software, and working very nicely. So if you use it, it's quite intuitive how to use. As you can see, well, there is, of course, the open command. So we have to open our file, the distribution file. So in my directory, I find texture phase 1 SMT. We open that one. And this is how it shows. So it shows texture at strain equal to 1. 2000 grains. It shows what is the orientation of the. Let me read from here. Axis length of the macro ellipsoid and what is its orientation. And then there are the orientations. So if the extension of the file is SMT, then the code automatically recognizes the format from this small letter, which is here B. It knows the format and we read automatically. Otherwise, you have to set up how many lines are in the header, which are no importance for the calculation, which should not be counted. What is the separation, space or tabulator, and then degrees or radians, and what phase you are looking at, which position the Euler angles are. All these are here. But it's automatically read, so it put it even that the cubic structure, crystal structure, it doesn't show, but we can make it visible. It's the cubic one. As you can see from the list, all different crystal textures can be treated. So we choose the cubic, and then just read. This command is just to read. So to read it, we execute there. You put your cursor, I put my finger on it, and then it says the data were read successfully. Okay, so we come back to the initial configuration. Now we have different options. So we can plot pole figures, ODFs, inverse pole figures. We can treat data from X-ray and different other options and tools are available. Texture components can be examined, comparing textures. Even simulations can be done here, the kind what we are doing with the self-consistent model. Here, in this simulation package here, there is the METS self-consistent code. And of course you can save, and you will see that there is even an option to publish. You press a button, it goes into a Word file, and already edited with the figures and then all the parameters. You just have to add your scientific remarks, and then you can send it for publication. So let's see first the pole figures. And this is how it looks like. And here, already set up for four pole figures. So the HKL indices are defined here, 111 pole figure, 100, 110, and 112. But of course, you can choose one of them if you want. You actually have to touch with the mouse here, these top positions, and then you can choose the one you want to look at it more closely. And of course, there are many other options here, whether you want stereographic pole figure, you want equal area pole figure. I propose that we use a stereographic one, and then the resolution, how it is going to be calculated. Usually they are set up everything properly, and you can choose here for the presentation of the pole figure a couple of interesting features. We will look at them, but what it is. So first thing to do is just to run it. So it's always this sign here. It means rapidly. Let's get the results rapidly. And there is a bar below which shows the advance of the calculation, and then the pole figures are plotted. This is something else, it's not the same calculation what you were doing. Here I'm just showing the procedure. Yes. Now, if we choose to study just one pole figure, then it's also possible. I was touching here that position. And then only one pole figure is visible. Now, it's very important for a pole figure to know where are the axes, how it is defined. Never publish a pole figure without showing what are the axes, because texture is orientation distribution. So the reference system is extremely important. This is why my colleagues put here this small sign. You see that? This one, X, Y, and Z. Meaning that direction X is vertical. It's not horizontal. It's vertical, and Y is horizontal to the left. This choice was made because usually rolling textures are studied. I don't know why people like rolling textures, but anyway. And for rolling texture, rolling direction is always put vertical in the figures. So that's why rolling direction is number one. Number one is X, so X is oriented vertical. And so you have to know that this is the X direction, Y direction, and Z, or direction 1, 2, and 3. 3 is going out like that. This is important because the Euler angles from which we just calculated the pole figure are defined in X, Y, Z reference system with respect to the sample system. So whatever was the simulation before, where there was also a reference system, now the program is assuming that phi 1, phi, and phi 2 angles refer to x1, x2, x3, or xyz. And as the Euler angle is defined, it is using that definition simply. It doesn't make any new, doesn't change reference system. The fact that X is vertical, it doesn't mean that the texture is rotated. Because X is defined, this is my X, I am not rotated, I am just plotting in this way. Okay? Doesn't mean rotation. because x, y, z is defined together with the pole figure. Now, we have, of course, the isovalues, which represent the intensity levels. Those ones you can read here with the color code, yeah, from 07 up to 629 here. This is an automatic range choice of intensities. The 6, for example, means 6 times random. 0.7 means less than random, because the random intensity would be 1 everywhere on the pole figure. So if you have a very good random texture, and if you plot a pole figure which is not deformed, so without deformation, random texture, then what would you see in this pole figure if it is really random? Nothing, because the intensity is supposed to be 1 everywhere, so that not even isolines should be made. Of course, this is very ideal, and then there is always some small texture intensity, and then the program will automatically make some scale. So there will be something. Now, you can play with the way it is presented. Now it is just contours, but we can, for example, fill the contours. So that is going to be then different. Yeah, we can show the contours and filling also. You choose the next option, and then you have the lines and also the color filling, according to your taste. Or you can make the circles option. But the circle option is plotting some kind of circles like this. I don't know what's the point, but I tell you which one I like, is this one. When we have at the same time the filling of the colors and the ISO levels. So, now, you might want to save this and put into your paper. Yeah. Now, but you don't like that the x is x and y like that. Yeah. You would like it because it's, let's say, that's your choice, and it looks better with respect to your other figures. Then you want the x on the right side. Yeah. That would mean a rotation to the right. So then you can define that rotation, which is going to be not here. This is the so-called wolf net. You can superimpose a wolf net to see the positions to which angles they correspond to. You can go here. These are the tools. These are the tools to define rotations and other things. Then you have a new window in which you can check whether you like all the parameters which are there. Calculation method, C coefficients. That's good, that's the best. Box size, 5 degrees. We don't know what is box size, but okay, 5 degrees is small enough. So let's leave it. I know what it is. Sample symmetry, that's important. Triclinic. Then we can think, does it apply to our case or not? Do we have any symmetry? Are we expecting symmetry? We want to force or not? These are sample symmetries, not crystal symmetries. There is triclinic, there is, I think these things were discussed by Professor Biswas. You can have monoclinic symmetry around X, Y, or Z. You can make orthorhombic or axisymmetric around Z. So triclinic is when there is no symmetry imposed at all. This is the best, because if after you see some symmetries, then you can begin to think, should I have a symmetry? Is it nearly symmetric? Should I apply really to make it fully symmetric? It's up to you. Then, very important, Gaussian width here, 5 degrees. What that means? Well, these textures, when they are plotted from individual grain orientations, they make it continuous. One single point in the ODF doesn't mean anything. So to make it continuous, a Gaussian distribution is put around that orientation. And it's 5 degrees by default value. And you might want to change it. For many reasons, you can use other values. The 5 degree is an average good value. If you have very deformed material and you would like to a little bit to mimic the deformation, the orientation gradient within a grain, you might permit more spread in orientation. Because the 5 degrees is already a spreading, meaning that I let the crystal orientation to be this within 5 degrees. But when you measure what is the, in a deformed crystal, the orientation gradient, you might see even 15, 20 degrees differences. So it's up to you then to play with this parameter. The consequence of changing the Gaussian width for these individual grain orientations is the texture intensity. If you make it wider, the general texture intensity will decrease. That permits you to a little bit to approach the experimental texture intensities, but you might not succeed. This is not the only parameter which is influencing that. So let's leave it 5 degrees. Now, isotropic part, 0. You could add an isotropic texture behind your simulation. You are not doing that now. Development even, development odd. So these are related to the C coefficients. So the default value is 22 and 21. But this is a spherical harmonic coefficient series which describes the continuous ODF. 22 and 21 is a good value, but there is no difficulty for the program to use higher values, meaning better precision. There are effects which are visible. Usually I'm using 32 and 31. Then I will show an example later that what effects can happen. Then phase is number one. Oh, here we can rotate. Perhaps we do not like it that X is like that. We would like X horizontal. Then we put here 90 degree rotation around 0, 0, 1 axis. That's it. Here I'm not doing anything. I can do. I do 90 degree. 90 degree. And then, of course, this has to be executed. These are the ranges of the ODF sections. So here, we push that button. It is done. But now this has to be recalculated. So we touch here. And it will be rotated 90 degrees. Here we go. The texture is rotated. The reference system is not. It is still X, you see, Y, and Z. But at least we can present our texture in 90 degree rotated plotting. But the reference system is here. It is kept always the same. So let me do it. But not even necessary to put it back because I have no constraints. Now, another option is the ODF. Euler sections here. If we choose that one, then this window comes, in which first we have to decide if we want Euler sections in phi 1 constant or in phi 2 constant. So phi 1 and phi 2 constant, they are here. We have to select one of the options. In the new version, there is a new version already. It is always phi 2, because we actually prefer the phi 2 sections, almost all the cases. And then the list of proposed sections appear. There are plenty of them. If you leave like that and execute, you will have the ODF in many small sections. Okay, and from 0 to 360 degrees. Phi 1 angle is here. There is the last here, this last box which is added here. It defines actually what is the reference system for the ODF. It is written here phi 1, 0, 360, the range. Written here phi 0 to 90 degree. And the phi 2 is actually written here within the figure. This angle means the phi 2 angle. But this shows the whole ODF, only 3 degrees a difference in different sections, only 3 degrees. For the simulation you did, I was asking only 2 sections because it was simple shear, so I was asking only the 0 and 45 degree. So you unselect all here, you unselect and we will tick only 2 sections, 0 and 45. So 0 and 45 and recalculate. Here we go. Now again for again for representation we can have just the lines, or we can have filled lines, or all the same options as for the pole figures. So this is my option. I choose that one, filled contours, but it doesn't change immediately. It's waiting that I give the command here. So I give that command and then it is colored. So that for the ODF this is how it works. There is always one extra section showing the reference system. There is also the bar, the ISO levels, what you need to also copy and then to use in your publication. So how to publish this? Because it's, let's say, so good that I want to put immediately into my paper. So for that purpose, here is this option, this one. This is really interesting what they did. If you do that, something is happening and the picture comes back, and at the same time a Word document opens automatically on your computer, in which you find the result copied into a Word document. So here it is. This is the top part of the Word document, JTEX and so on and so forth. Report on the texture phase 1. Contents, it's almost a paper. Yes? And here is our figure. So it's very easy to put actually your obtained simulation results into a document and then to do whatever you want to do with it. Of course, we forgot to put the pole figures. So let's add the pole figures. For that purpose, we go back to the pole figure window. Here it is. And if you are happy with this, we touch here to put it also into the paper. Okay? So we touch it. I hope it is made. I'm not sure. Let me touch it again. I'm not sure about the result. It actually opened a new Word document. Or it is working on it. No. Yeah. You're making trouble. I did. I managed to. When you are not patient enough, and sometimes for computers you have to be patient, they are very sensitive. So now it seems that I crashed my JTEX. No, JTEX is still there. Okay. So let's see what is in this document. Well, only the ODF. Didn't manage to put the pole figure, but what is important that all the calculation parameters are also there in the document, and even I think the date, no date, but all the parameters are there. So I still try once more. My pole figure was closed. I recalculate again the pole figures. I choose only one. This one. I make it field contours. It's automatic. And then I try to publish. Again, another file is opening. Now I will be more patient. I do not succeed apparently. I should have done immediately. Anyway, so this is a sensitive issue apparently. Now, another thing I wanted to show you, it's for the Euler sections here. The ODF intensity was calculated with C coefficients up to 22, which is a large value. But if you want to improve precision, you can go up to higher values. So for that purpose, you go back into the control parameters. And in the control parameters, he doesn't like me anymore, JTEX, so I have to quit, it seems to me. What happens if one thing is not working, he doesn't obey anymore. Okay. I have to restart my JTEX. I got it. So now it is put into the output document file. Okay. Now we will look into the other features here. But I have to do first a simulation which corresponds to simple shear to get the nice simple shear texture. Then I can show you additional features which are very important and very sympathetic to use the software. Now what we will do is go back into the code. Into the presentation. And see some of the results of the simulation. Okay, here we go. So this is what I was asking you to do. Okay, so you did the simple shear, full constraints, up to shear strain of 2 by increments of 0.05 on 1,000 random orientations. Strain rate sensitivity was 20. And then these two sections were asked. And trying different alpha values to see what texture differences you can have. So I show you what an experimental texture should be. For what we were simulating is FCC material up to shear strain of 2. So here this one is copper up to shear strain of 2. So you can see this is what I'm expecting from you, the 0 and 45 degree sections of the ODF. I managed to put on them the names of the ideal components also. This is automatic, but I have to show you how to do. That, of course, is very convenient to put into publications and then refer to the names. So this is automatic. You can put these four textures which are in the right reference system and which are known, including hexagonals. So we find here the A1C, A2 components in the 5-0 section. And in the 45 section, A and B, the C reappears, A2 and A1. Actually, this line here is identical to this line here. It just shifted. And we have the singular slip component, double slip, and double slip. This is what we expect to obtain by the simulation. In the pole figure, it's similar. Yeah. We can see immediately that it's not symmetric. You see the shift. The shear was applied in positive direction of x. So this was the shearing process. I put here a small sign for the shear. We sheared in this way, and then orientations accumulated before the ideal position. As expected, we know that there is a convergence in shear deformation in orientation space, which is producing these tilts of the components. And then and this is what's happening in the experiment. We hope that also in the simulation we will get that. Now, there is this fiber, it's a so-called B fiber, which appears here, also here, and there. You see the names on it. This is coming from the software, the names of the ideal components. And the A fiber is here, that one and the other one, also with the names. Now, the problem of a pole figure is that the orientations, which seem to be very near here, in reality, they might be very far from each other, and they are overlapping. So it's difficult to speak about the intensity of components. Like here, the C looks very strong, yeah? But here the C at this position looks not very strong. So why it is so? Because there are other positions where several orientations are overlapping, here at least four, at this position, other components. And they are making apparently a big peak, but that's artificial. This is why you have to look at the ODF, when orientations are clearly separated, no overlapping, then you can be sure about the relative intensities. Okay, so this is a kind of good experimental reference. Let's see a simulation that which I was doing. For gamma shear strain of 2, I used the static model, so the effective parameter in the VPSC code was put very high, 100, to approach the static model, and this is the obtained texture, which is on the top. So I also present here the experimental one, yeah, to compare and to have already ideas how successful we are. It seems to be not too bad, at the same time not too good, right? But if something is not too bad, not too good, we have to continue. There is obviously one problem. C component, you know, is not coming strong enough. Do we have the rotation of the texture? We do. This is reproduced already here. So this shift, practically agreeing with the experiment, is nicely already there. This six-fold peaks here, they appear more or less. Intensity ratios are bad, right? That's obvious. Like here, this is strong. In the experiment, it should be here. So we are not very happy, and we say that, static model, forget about it for this material. So we go to the tangent model. In the tangent model, we put the n value equal to 20, which is 1 over the strain rate sensitivity, and then we look at it. I say that something better came out. Yep. So C is getting stronger. At least A2 is appearing more normally, because previously even the A2 was not strong enough. In experiment it is quite strong. So now A2 is coming better. We have A, B, and B, all these components. So there is a net good amelioration, a better result. Go to now the so-called finite element tuned version, when the effective value would be 1 over 66. Well, here another positive points appear, actually. Now the C component really is getting the good intensity, a little bit localized though. So here, to get this kind of bigger peak, one would try to increase the Gaussian spread. was 5 degrees, so perhaps he should use 7. And then we would get a bigger peak to approaching this one better. That is actually more or less a parameter, the Gaussian spread. One must use that to produce the continuous ODF. But the rotation of the texture is there. We have clearly this fiber here. Yeah. So half of the A fiber is pronounced in the experiment and also in the simulation. But it's a little bit too much localized, I admit. But you know, we didn't play perhaps correctly with the hardening. Perhaps the initial grain shapes was not perfectly spherical, which is assumed in this modeling. Once I did, not long ago, a simulation where the simulation was already quite good, but my student didn't notice that initial grains were already elongated somehow. I put into the modeling and repeated the simulation, and then beautiful textures, a lot of good features came immediately. Hardening can be also important, because now we are in a version of the code, which is called the finite element tube version. Seems to be quite pretty good, it permits really very different deformations for the grains. The grains are still quite free. The more free the grains are in the static mode, and the less free in the Taylor mode. They are constrained. You didn't see the Taylor. So let's see now what Taylor will produce here. Ah, there is an error here on this page. I would like that you discover it. That's the Taylor calculation. I should have removed. Actually, I wanted, but then I said, oh, let's ask the new experts. You are the new experts. To find what is the mistake on this slide. F what? N. So Taylor here, yeah, and this should be 0. Here you go. That's right. It's not compatible. Yes. It was just copied from one page to the other. So N effective, of course, is 0, which leads to the Taylor model. And looking at the Taylor model, well, there are nice features. Yeah, it's not really bad. I mean, there is a with respect to the static, for example, is really very bad with respect to this one. So there are good features, but they are not perfect. So the material actually really behaves according to the self-consistent conditions. I would say that with these parameters what we had, this probably is the best approximation of the texture. Needs to be fixed up here. You see these lines there, which appear like that? They are not real. They are coming from the C coefficients. The C coefficients is a periodic functions which describe the intensity of one component. They are periodic functions, and then sometimes they go up, they go down, and when they go up, they make artificial things here. To get rid of them, the only way is to increase the C coefficient ranking. 22 is the default value. Go up to 32, then they will disappear. At the same time, because they disappear, the intensity levels become also much better. The texture intensity, the local intensities will decrease. That effect can be seen. So that has to be done in JTEX, of course. I showed you where it was, where the parameter is. And then these kind of ghosts, they are not really ghosts, because these are positive values here. There is no negative value here in the ODF. but this is a kind of thing that not in the experiment and then can be actually erased with proper parameter values. Okay, so I hope that you succeeded. Did anybody get all these nice textures? Yes? Yeah? Do you feel good? Satisfied with your simulation? These simulations are quite classic, but this is how you have to start with. For example, it's not sufficient. This is the shear textures. But you should also look at the other more classical texture area, the rolling textures. So actually, I have also example for that case. So here are the rolling simulations. Okay, so this is the same kind of exercise. Now you change into another strain mode. So you do rolling. It's quite easy now. Once you set up everything, you have your initial file. You have your slip system file. You don't even have to touch them. You just only change in the VPSC 5 in parameter file, the strain mode. You prescribe rolling. So rolling here would be, we approximate with plane strain compression. So our velocity gradient will be like 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and minus 1. Which means that rolling on direction 3, and this is the rolling direction, this is the rolling plane. This is the only thing that has to be changed. You can remain with the other conditions the same, except that you have to look at the strain. In rolling, it is much more difficult to get into large strain. It's some limited approximately at about strain of 3. Here I talk about, of course, the logarithmic true strain, not the so-called rolling reduction. You can go up to 98%, very difficult to reach 98% rolling reduction, which would correspond about a total strain of 3. In shear, you can go much more easily, much higher values, also experimentally. So that's why we are more modest, rolling strain only 1, increment 0.02. You also have to be aware here that these strains, what we talk about here, and the accumulated values which come out in the code, they are always the true strains. It's not engineering strain. Engineering strain is what you can measure in experiment as a first measure, and then you are supposed to convert it into true strain, which is a logarithmic calculation. You have to make an integration because of the change in thickness. So, for example, in rolling, so you have an initial thickness, which is, let's say, H0, yeah, and then you make the compression to a certain value, which is thickness would be h.
Yeah.
And then in one increment, the deformation in this direction, d epsilon, would be something like change in the height divided by the actual height.
Yeah.
So then you have to integrate it. Yeah. You get epsilon on this side, on the other side, you get the logarithmic function let me do it, it's ln h between the initial h0 and final situation. So it is producing ln h divided by h0. Yeah? It's because h is less than h0, it's going to be less than 1. It's a negative value because we are doing here compression. So this is how you calculate. It's always a kind of logarithmic value, the strain. So all the strain values which come out in the code, they are in logarithmic true strain. Now, I propose you doing this simulation work after you check your JTEX calculations. I don't know what is the advancing in terms of texture plotting. Did you already do or not yet?
Yes.
Everybody did? Everybody finished that part?
Yes.
Yes? Any question on that part? For JTEX? Yes? Yes.
So how does it calculate? Does it take the average of the values of one quadrant?
Well, it is just the symmetry issue. It concerns the sample symmetry. I'm going to explain it for the rolling. The rolling rolling testing. I'll try to make a nice figure. Okay, here is the sample. Rolling direction, rolling plane. So you have your sample. And you roll it. This is axis 1, here is axis 3, and then 1, 2 is going to be in that direction. Now, the symmetry, the sample symmetry, which you can impose in JTEX, is related to the symmetry of the testing. You have to think what is changing if I do something in the test with respect to symmetry. For example, one operation is that I roll, I make one increment of rolling, I have the sample in my hand, and I decide to put it upside down. So instead of this is up and the other surface is down, I will put back opposite. Yeah, I have two rolls, yeah, there are two rolls here. Yeah. Which one is up, which one is down, for the sample, he doesn't know. They are perfectly similar. So what do I doing? I'm applying a rotation of 180 degrees around axis 1 to the sample and put it back and continue testing. Actually, it's obvious to us, for everybody, I believe, yes, that there should be no difference, whether it is up or down. If the rolls are the same, if they are not the same, well, in my case they are not, so I have to do it better. In differential rolling, asymmetric rolling, one would put different diameters here, or one would run identical diameters with different speeds. And then there is a difference. But if they run with the same angular speed, they have the same size, the sample doesn't know which one is up, which one is down. So there is a symmetry, which is 180 degrees around axis 1. That's a twofold symmetry. Twofold means that by two operations, I get back into the initial situation. Twice 180 is 360. I can do also other thing. I choose axis 2, okay, axis 2, and then I take the sample back, but rotate around axis 2 180 degrees, yeah? Not 1, but axis 2. I find that it is also possible. It would not make any difference like the previous one. So I did already twice, discovered two symmetries, one around axis 1, twofold, another around axis 2, twofold. Well, these twofold symmetries around two axes will automatically imply that there is symmetry also around axis 3, another twofold symmetry, around each axis. But it's sufficient to prove that there are around two axes twofold symmetry that will lead to twofold symmetry around axis 1, around axis 2, it leads to orthotropic symmetry. Orthotropic symmetry. That means that when you look at your pole figure, axis 1, axis 2, then there is symmetry around this 180 degrees. So if there is a point here, there will be a point there, yeah? Symmetrically. Also, the same for axis 1. If there is a point here, there must be a point there. This is the so-called orthotropic symmetry. So basically, these two axes become a mirror axis for the pole figure. Now, the case of simple shear, this you can enforce. You enforce it in the program. Forcing it, it will guarantee that the intensity here will be the same as there, and here and there, the respective symmetry, according to the symmetry, intensities are the same. The program is just forcing it. You might not want to do it. My colleagues, usually experts in texture measurements, they always tell me that we don't like it. We do not want to force. We want to see how much deviations are there. And if symmetry is really there, it will be visible immediately. Small deviations are always permitted. But if you artificially symmetrize it, the experiment, then actually you introduce something new which coming not from the experiment, it's coming from you. But for simulations, when you perfectly control all parameters and you know that it should be symmetric, then of course you can impose symmetry if you are sure that it should be, but it is not because I don't have enough grains, and then so on and so forth. Then you can do it, but not for the experiment. Experiment, just leave it in triclinic symmetry and then discover, verify the existence of symmetries which are expected or not. You might make a mistake. For example, in ECAP. ECAP is a simple shear process. So that means, now let's go into ECAP. In ECAP, Let's do 90 degree a cup. There is a shear plane here, and this is the shear process. What is the symmetry here? For simple shear, in general, there is one symmetry around the axis perpendicular to the shear in the shear plane, twofold symmetry. So that symmetry is 180 degrees. As you can see, if I take my deformed material, it's deformed in this way, and then take it out and put it back, I can put it upside down, it will take exactly the same shape. 180 degree rotation of the sample around this axis, this is the axis of twofold symmetry, will make exactly the same shape as before, no difference. So that means that simple shear process has a twofold symmetry axis around this, which is in the plane of shear and perpendicular to the shear. This is the axis here, coming out from the whiteboard, like that. But this symmetry, the existence of that symmetry in the texture requires that the initial texture already has that symmetry. This symmetry implies in the pole figure, so this is axis 1, axis 2, okay, 1 and 2. The twofold symmetry implies the following. If there is a texture intensity here, then rotating this around this axis by 180 degrees, I have to have the same intensity in the rotated position. That brings me here. This is exactly opposite to the center. That's why we call it centrosymmetry. Twofold symmetry around this axis is actually centrosymmetry. So the pole figure in this presentation should be centrosymmetric. But if your initial texture was not centrosymmetric, you cannot expect that it becomes centrosymmetric because of this shear. You have to be sure that the initial texture was centrosymmetric. Then you did the shear, which is also such process, symmetry process, then you can expect that after one pulse of a cup, your shear texture will be centrosymmetric. And if it is largely, very much deviating from that, then you might ask the question, was my texture symmetric initially? Or do I have enough statistics? Do I see enough grains? Because to have this symmetry, of course, you need infinite number of grains. These symmetry issues, they assume that there is a grain there. There's a grain only there if there are many, many large number of grains, so there will be a grain there. So statistically, in each case, you have to have very, very large number of grains. If you do an EBSD measurement and want to represent the texture out of it, then you have to think very carefully on all these issues. Already, the non-existence of symmetry is expected symmetry will seriously question the validity of your thinking, what you think on the results. Plenty of papers are published now, textures shown from EBSD measurements, and people usually, because this is a feature, you can plot it from EBSD, it's already in the software. You can get ODF, pole figure, whatever you want. Even this rotation axis distributions, many things. But you have to understand that for texture, which is a statistical kind of quantity, you need large statistics. you have to have large number of grains. Forget about textures if you have don't have at least 3,000 grains, preferably 10,000 grains detected by your measurement technique. That can be easily satisfied with X-ray, because X-rays see all the grains on the surface, unless they are very large grains, because then even in the X-ray measurement, you will run into the same problems as in EBSD measurements. So all these things has to be carefully thought, and then when you think of textures, already the expected symmetries show you that, okay, I am fine. I got the right symmetries, and my texture components are there where they are supposed to be, so my texture is really representative. That was for root A. Root A, you can continue. You can take the sample out and put back and pass several times. If you always do root A, the symmetry will remain, will not be deteriorated. Root A means that when you take the sample out, sample is here, taken out from the die. This is the starting part of the sample. You rotate your sample 90 degrees around its axis, translate it, and put back here. So you do a rotation with respect to your processing. Your processing is here. Now you take your sample, rotate it, and put it back. That's already a manipulation which should not be forgotten, of course. I mean, you have to. The sample like this would not go back into the channel, so you do it automatically. But make sure that you put this part first here, and not the back part. So the sample should be like this. The leading part here is that one. It's not this one. You rotate minus 90 degrees, not plus 90 degrees, when you put it back. With this operation only, you can continue and doing root A several passes. Symmetry of the texture will remain. But if you do root B, BC or BA, or root C is fine. Root B would involve a rotation around this axis 90 degrees. That rotation around this axis obviously is nothing to do with this here. You lose your symmetry. So if you introduce a root B, even if you put it back and this process, your process has the symmetry, but because of this rotation, your texture doesn't have the symmetry with respect to the process. Your texture is losing symmetry. And then you will see that your texture becomes non-symmetric in root B. That's normal. There is nothing wrong with that. If you do root C, interestingly, is going to be 180 degrees rotation around the sample axis. That is will keep the twofold symmetry valid. Okay, now if you did already the simulation for your simple shear, and then you also plotted the textures, perhaps what I'm going to do is I just show you what changes happen for the rolling case. You can do your simulation independently yourself. You have the experience. And after I go back to JTEX and show you how to put the ideal orientations on the figures. So for rolling simulations, let's begin with the tangent model. The tangent model is for strain sensitivity 20 is n effective 20, strain minus 1 to the pole figure 1, 1, 1, pole figure. This is FCC rolling is shown, and then the two sections of the ODF, the 0 and the 45 degree section. This is a typical rolling texture by simulation. Here I don't show you an experiment. And it's quite a good texture because it has the so-called copper component, which is actually here, and then somewhere here. It has all the features which corresponds to a classical rolling texture simulation. This is the so-called alpha fiber here, very nicely coming. We have the gauss, the brass, the copper component. This is the Taylor component. And again, the gauss is appearing here. The same which is here is the reproduction of that part. So this is quite a good simulation already. If we use the finite element tuned version in this case, then we still have a good texture, with the difference that the copper component is shifting a little bit towards the Taylor component. Now we do the Taylor model, and this is what the first modeling was done, you know, already in the 50s, when they discovered that the texture is the most intense here instead of there. The experiments, they showed the texture intensities on the top. There is this so-called Taylor component. So the copper is shifting to the Taylor. And in experiment, it is the copper component which is there. So the classical Taylor model had a very big problem because it did not reproduce correctly the components. The brass component is also very weak. Look at the difference with respect to this one. This is a beautiful, looks like an experimental texture. So for rolling, the self-consistent model is really very good. Ah, look at these here. You see? They can be made disappear with increasing the C coefficients. Okay, now we will go back to JTEX. I first have to do a short simulation work in order to get the right texture on which we will put the ideal orientations. So what I propose is that we will make a break now. During the break I will do my simulation, and then after we will look at how to put the ideal components into the ODF. Okay? So see you later. Break, 15 minutes. Okay, then shall we continue? I did some simulation work, several simulations actually. I am showing you the last one. It's quite interesting. And at the same time, I will show you also how to put the ideal orientations on in the figures. So the simulation here is a simple shear, what I was asking from you, but with 10,000 random grain orientations. I created these 10,000 grains by the JTEX software. JTEX is able to create random distributions. It's not very difficult. I'll show you. It is here in the tools option. In the tools option, you go to generate. And then the options are single orientations, fibers, or random. So you can choose random, cubic structure. And then the bottom is asking how many orientations you want. So I put 10,000. And then generate, and then it made my file. That is leads to better simulation results. You always have to have a large number of grains. I propose you that in your future simulations, first you use relatively low number of grain orientations, like 1,000, 2,000, 3,000. But when you get good results, then you increase the number to the maximum possible, what your conditions permit, like 50,000 grains even. And then run it again, and you get really very fine, excellent statistics and textures. So I did that work, and the other change I made here, that it is simply with 10,000 initially random grains, but I wanted to see what the co-rotation of neighbors option will do to my texture. And then the result is, I did the simulation already. It's a little bit longer than for 1,000 grains, of course, so we are not going to repeat that. We just go directly into the JTEX, open that file, that simulation file. You can see it's right here, text 51 SMT, which was made at 4:51. You always check. That's another mistake you can make during your simulations, that you use a file which was saved somewhere else. It has the same name, but it was made already 1 week ago. And then you look at something else which does not correspond to your latest simulation. One way is to check always the date. Was it? It is there. To check it was made now. Okay, this is the file I just made. I am not making any mistake. That's a very important point. So let's open that. As you can see, it has 10,000 grain orientations. It is written here, the 10,000. And then read it. It is successful. And then go to pole figures, calculate the pole figures. It is running down there. It's quite fast, pole figure calculation. Here they are. Now I only want to look at one pole figure. My favorite is the 111. This one. You see, this is shear strain of 2 with this co-rotation scheme. Looks quite good. Surprisingly low intensities. The maximum is only 2.76. The intensity is too low. In the experiment, it would be like something like 4 or 5. So already the simulation leads to a little bit too weak textures, but all the features are there. The rotation is there, except that there is another component, which is the A component, appearing and rotating in opposite direction. That's suspicious, because in experiment we see the A component. This is a special simulation also, because it was constructed for aluminium alloy hardening. So a special hardening rule was used, I'm using right now in the simulation, which leads different textures what you obtained just by changing the hardening parameters. So strain hardening is an important point to discover and model properly. You measure strain hardening, you simulate it with your code, you get the parameters, and then you use it for the real simulation. Here, this texture is very different from what you were calculating. Now, look at the ODF. We will plot the phi 2 constant sections in 0 degree and 45 degree. It's coming. We put it into field contours mode. And here is the ODF. Now, this is again quite low, of course. The maximum intensity is, I will try to put it full screen. Yeah. not too bad, 4.71, so intensity I am satisfied. But I see that all components are coming nicely, except that this should be kind of major component, the A2. This is A1, C, and A2. You remember in the measurement and our simulations, your simulations, they gave here a nice component. So that is not very satisfactory. But this is, you know, I use the co-rotation scheme facility of the self-consistent code. It is there. It is producing good intensities for the texture, while your simulations were giving intensity values up to 25. Yes? Did you look at it? High intensity values, which are unreasonably high. Now, these are more or less correct, but one feature here, we didn't get it. We don't know why, but this is how it works. Anyway, now we will try to put the ideal components of shear textures. I did the simulation in this reference system, so direction 1 and direction 2, and for that deformation mode, the ideal components can be calculated. It is this option here. Let's go there. And there we can choose the texture components we want to plot and examine. Well, you can do one component if you want, and it will be analyzed. But we are going to choose the list, because there are lists prefabricated, so that all the components will be seen at the same time. From the list, list is quite... I choose from list, yes. And then there is options for shear FCC, shear BCC, shear HCP, rolled FCC, rolled BCC, rolled HCP. So we will of course choose the sheared FCC, and then immediately the major components of these shear textures are here, together with their names and their Miller indices and Euler positions. And one reference shows here, this is one of my paper, from which you can learn more about these components. So that now we calculate them. Sorry?
Sample symmetry is triclinic.
Yes, it's triclinic. Although we could impose here the monoclinic, right? But it would not change too much. We will try. Here we got the list of the components, these major components, together with their ODF intensities. These values here, their ODF intensities in the ideal position. And these values here are the volume fractions. Attention, it is in percentage. So this means 0.3% only. 0.3%. These different components which appear in the ODF, they are impressive, but in reality, each of them corresponds to small volume fractions, because ODF space is very big. And then integrating just in a small part of it, we get low fractions. We will see if we impose symmetry here. It's not here, it has to be done in the here. Yeah. Monoclinic, around which axis? We have to choose Z. We were deforming direction 1, plane 2. So the monoclinic symmetry axis is Z. That we can choose if you want, because it's a simulation, it should be symmetric. So we impose that. Then we recalculate this one. It's going on. Check if there is any change in the values. No. They are about the same values. in spite of, because it, the texture itself is quite symmetric. Actually, on the pole figure, we can see them. You see, this texture is nearly fully well symmetric because I used 10,000 grains. But I tried first at 1,000, and it was visibly not very satisfactory symmetric. This is why I increased to 10,000 grain orientations. So now with this calculation where we got the texture components, now we know what are their intensities. For example, A2, I just showed you, it's very low, below random, while it is in experiment is a major component. So this is this approach apparently is not very good. I would say wrong, but it is there. Never mind. Now, having that, we will put the ideal orientations first on the pole figures. Here we are in the pole figure window. So we will go to texture components. In the texture components, we say show components with names. And they are there. They appear. Usually a problem that the letters are too small. And then you want to put into publication, it's no good. So there is an option for that. Component size can be increased. Let's say if I make it 20. Yeah, it is bigger. The ideal positions are also marked that they are bigger. So you see, this permits a very nice immediate publication of the result. Now, we go to the ODF. Here in the ODF, we have to do the same manipulation. We have to choose the texture components, show by names, and here, to get the operation, this has to be touched, that point. We got it, but they are small. Again, we will increase the size of the letters. That is better. Now we can examine how individual orientations are appearing with respect to the ideal positions. So C is in position. We have all major components. This is obviously a shear texture. So this figure like this is immediately publishable. You publish with this button here, and it goes into a Word file. If you touch that button, it's going to make image file for the texture, which can be also used, of course, for publishing. What else I wanted to show here? Yes, if you do ECAP in this reference system, then the ideal orientations will be rotated by 45 degrees. Yeah, you measure the textures. The C component would not be here, but it would be 45 degree rotated. Even in that case, you can rotate the ideal components and put them into the right position. For that purpose, we go back here into this window, and we will rotate each component. Here is a rotation option by 45 degree. First, we have to choose here one component and then touch rotate. Then we choose a second component. Unfortunately, this has to be done one by one. My colleagues were unable to make it at the same time. It's a little bit complex. Rotated all of them, 45 degrees. Oh, no, I didn't. didn't specify the rotation angle. So I did nothing. Here is the rotation angle, okay, 45 degrees. And now we will rotate. Around axis Z. Rotated. So they are now rotated 45 degrees. Of course, our testing is not a cup, but let's see how it is functioning. Now we recalculate the volume fractions. They will be wrong because it doesn't correspond to the texture. You see, everything changed, and small intensities. That's not a problem. Now we go here, and then just have to touch here to put the components 45 degree rotated, all of them. I hope so. Oh yes, it is done. The C component was here, now it is here. A1 was here, moved there, and A2 was actually here and moved 45 degrees to appear on the other side. Everything is moved. Now you see there is no correspondence between the orientations and the ideal components. You always have to be quite, serious in terms of textures. Apparent similarities between experiment and simulation is not sufficient, or between experiment and ideal positions. Sometimes I see horrible publications in which people say, we got our nice shear texture. This has nothing to do with shear, the texture itself. So you have to be very critical with respect to your results, because there are plenty of possibilities to make mistakes. Just by all these numerical calculations and then analysis, even the analysis of your experimental data needs to use a lot of softwares. Plenty of possibilities to make mistakes. So you have to be very critical in each time for your own results, that they should be absolutely reliable. Especially if you want to publish them. You know that rule number one of publishing is that you are absolutely sure about what you are presenting. You're absolutely sure that it's correct and it is the best what you can obtain and there is no mistake in it. Then you can publish. If ever you are not sure about something and publish, you make a very big mistake, because yourself or others can find out later that was totally wrong. And then you lose a lot of credibility, which you shouldn't. You can easily avoid always making absolutely sure that your results are perfectly correct. So that's what I wish to you in the future, that it's going to be like that. And then your publications will be appreciated and highly cited. Any further questions? Because we are going to stop after this part. It is weekend, yeah. You would like to go perhaps to a pub and then to a discotheque or what? Or just doing simulations at home. Okay, any questions? If not, next week we can continue. Now you know much more about it and you will have much more many questions, I'm sure about. Thank you, I wish you a nice weekend and see you on Monday.